What's up, everyone? It's Gimson, and welcome to October's Q&A. So this month, I'm gonna keep it short and sweet because I find I go off on a tangent and waffle on when I don't prepare. So I prepared the questions this time, and I'm gonna try and keep each answer to under 1 minute. So let's get it. So first up, from Sonnies Edge, we had, how long have I been doing music? At the time of recording this, I am 34, and I started sort of making music when I was about 12-ish. I started on the Music Maker thing on the PlayStation, and Hip Hop EJ, but that wasn't, do you mean that was just like sequence drag and drop blocks? Then I moved on to Magix, before moving on to Cubase, when I was like sort of like late teens. But late teens, properly, I'd say mate, late teens, 16, 17, I was nowhere near as good. I'm like a wine, matured with age. My earlier stuff was, well, it's finding your feet, innit? So, but yeah, so started like when I was 12, but like properly, like sort of like 17. So next, Nick said, am I Santa? Yes, I have been for the last 5 years, but thankfully I only have to go to my own living room, mate. Be fucking exhausting, wouldn't it? Fucking going around the world in one night. I mean, I have got the greys. But yeah, so I am Santa, but only for my own kids, mate. Right, next up, we got a question from Josh. And Josh said, following from what Shaun asked about working with anyone, you named Dre and Kanye based off of their production. Who would you love to work with, excluding producers? I would love to work with, or collaborate with, I'd love to collaborate with Anthony Hamilton.
Woke up this morning, found a letter that she wrote. She said she's tired that I'm always on the road.
Or Mike Skinner from the Streets.
We haven't even started and it's almost the end. We never talked it over, fact we never said anything.
Plenty of others, but I think those would be great. Or even together on the same track. Imagine how that would sound. Me, Anthony Hamilton, and Mike Skinner from the Streets. Second question from Josh. Who has influenced me the most in my career? DMX. Let's go with DMX. DMX has influenced me the most. Or Tupac. I've got so many influences, but taking it back, if you're talking about my hip-hop influences would be the mostly those two. Because like through my initial years, through my teenage years, DMX and Tupac.
No matter how many tears your mom's cry, ain't gonna bring your ass back, plus in hell you gonna cry.
So Josh's third question was, have you ever wanted to give up on music? And if so, what made you keep going? I've never wanted to give up music. I've taken breaks from actively putting music out, but I've always been making music in the background. So I had quite a big break. So 2016 till now. So this year, like you probably noticed, I've been going like fucking fully at it. But between 2016 and now, like I kind of had a break. I put a track out in 2017 with Rosko, which was Dark Mist.
The sweet eating fiends knocking doors on Halloween. Diabetes in their teens, along with battered self-esteems. Broken promises, night terrors, fell dreams, portrayed in memes. The art of storytelling, let me tell you what I've seen.
I've never wanted to give up making music though. If anything, don't know if I like the idea of fame. I am petrified of people critiquing my music. I really am. It's thankfully I don't get many trolls, but it's always shit in it when someone says fucking some negative shit about your music or something you've created, something you've like really put something into, like really put your heart and like soul into, and like you've nurtured and you've made, and for someone to fucking come along and just give it some flippant comment. But I don't feed the trolls. That's one thing I don't do. Thankfully, I don't get many of them, but when I do, I don't feed them. Just respect and moved on. Fucking everyone's entitled to their opinion. It just seems to be that the internet is a place where people feel that their opinions and they're entitled, and it's like free speech, yeah, cool, but fucking like you gotta be in a bit of a shit place, haven't you, to be like going down the avenue of just being a cunt towards someone's music. So yeah, no, I don't think I'll ever give up, mate. It's a part of me, it's something I'll always do. I may not always be actively pushing out. I mean, this year I am fucking fully on it, but I'm in a very good, or I have been in a very good place mentally, really spent last 4 years looking after myself. And so yeah, but yeah, won't give up, not anytime soon, and yeah, yeah. Right, so Shaun said, what is my favorite song? Shaun asked me this last month, he said, what is my favorite song? And I said Tupac Holler at Me because I couldn't work it out. So he's asked me again this month, and this month I am going to say Anthony Hamilton, Charlene. It's probably not, but it's definitely up there. Ask me again next month. So following on from that, Shaun also said, what is my favorite instrumental? By instrumental, do you mean hip-hop instrumental, or do you just mean instrumental? I tell you what is a fucking cracking instrumental, is Jupiter from the Planets by Gustav Holst. If we're talking about hip-hop instrumentals, Onyx Last Days. Beanie Sigel, In the Air. Mobb Deep, Quiet Storm. So my next question from Shaun is, do you have any guilty pleasures, either a song or genre? If so, what? If you say no, I know you're a lion. Power ballads. I love power ballads. I'm not sure if they're a guilty pleasure, but they're definitely a pleasure. I wanna know what love is. Definitely a pleasure. Power ballads, mate. Next question from Shaun. Do I have a certain song that I go to when I'm in depressive moods? No, I don't have a specific song to go to, but what I'll do, I'll throw a few songs at you so you can kind of get the idea of where I go to in a depressive state. It'll be something slow with a lot of substance, a lot of context, a lot of meaning, a lot of pain in it. Like, I like to listen to music that amplifies my mood, not tries to change my mood. Like, I wouldn't go and listen to someone fucking happy or angry if I'm sad or a little bit depressed. So the type of songs I'll go to will be DMX, Slippin'. Slippin', slippin', fallin', I can't get up. Sound of Silence by Disturbed. Hello, darkness, my old friend. Hallelujah by Jeff Buckley. Crystal Cindy by Dirty Dyke.
Can't function on her feet, slumbered in the street. If it ain't the drugs or money, it's the company she keeps. And her mates think it's funny when she's sucking on her knees at a festival in front of everybody for a G.
Nothing Else Matters by Metallica. Staring at the World Through My Rear View by Tupac. Staring at the world through my rear view. Go ahead, baby, scream to God. He can't hear you. Tears in Heaven by Eric Clapton. Would you know my name if I saw you in heaven? That song, Tears in Heaven by Eric Clapton, fucking, like, if I'm gonna say a song which has probably got, like, tugs on the fucking heartstrings the most, it's probably that. I mean, if you're ever feeling low, you're in a depressive state, right? Go and listen to a song that a man wrote about his, like, was he, I can't remember what his song was, I think he was like 3 or 4, and he fell from a balcony and died, like, and if you want to fucking feel pain, go and listen to that song, man. Tears from Heaven by Eric Clapton is fucking, that will tug on your heartstrings, like, phew. Do you know what I mean? Like, yeah, that, like, yeah. How a man can take something so painful and make something so beautiful. Fucking cracking song. So Shaun's final question was, on a more positive, but at the same time deeper note, what came first, the chicken or the egg? Explain your choice. So I remember reading before by Neil Tyson deGrasse that he said, before the chicken came an egg that was not laid by a chicken. Like, the chicken evolved from something, so it came from an egg of another bird. So, the egg. Right, Rosko decided to get involved this month, and first question from Rosko is, are UFOs from outer space or just top secret government projects testing craft? Now this is interesting, isn't it? This is fucking really interesting. So, I don't know. Like, all these UFO sightings and that, they all sort of started like around the sort of time that we started fucking around with nukes and stuff, wouldn't it? They like really like went through the roof, like the 40s, 50s, 60s. But at the same time, so did a lot of technological advancements. You had the Russians working on a lot of stuff, it was the Germans, wasn't it? And then he went to Russia and then he went to America. So I don't know, mate. But I'll tell you something what I do fucking think is really interesting. So I don't know if you've heard of Fermi's paradox. And basically that is, in this, like, all these planets that we're looking at, and we're finding all these planets, but we still haven't found any signs of life. And there, I can't remember what it is, but there's an answer to the paradox and what it says. It kind of really fits in with like where sort of like Elon Musk and where humans are kind of going at the moment with the whole like Neuralink, upload your consciousness type thing. So basically they say, once a species gets to a certain level, so at the moment we're very much on like conquering and fucking taking over places and control and power, who controls this property and land and all that kind of tribal shit. So the answer to it is like, when a species gets so far beyond, it's like, well, they don't conquer outwards anymore. Like, why would you need to conquer outwards? It's like so what they do, they start to conquer inwards. And they actually go back in and sort of like fit in with the kind of thing. It's like, well, why do I need this like body? So first it'll be like, they'll go into like some sort of like robot form, and then they actually go back in themselves. By like going in and uploading their consciousness and becoming so powerful, and like they actually transcend this sort of reality and create something, become gods, so to speak, and create something else. So I thought that was really interesting. So they no longer be a part of this realm or this world. They become so powerful and technologically advanced that they just like fuck the body. Like, why do I need a body? Like, do you mean it's just hindering me? And it's just their consciousness becomes off into this, whatever. I mean, I can't really explain it because it's beyond the realms of my my sort of vocabulary. Unless I was to get on a DMT or something, innit? But even then, like, you can't really fucking explain in words what you see all the time. But yeah. See, I don't know, mate. I don't know about that. I do think at some point, I don't know, the conspiracy theorist in me thinks that there will be some sort of hoax that goes on. But yeah. Rosko's second question was, what do you think the weirdest song is that me and you have ever made? Sally Sandwich.
Sally had a sandwich. A gone off sandwich. And it made her very sick. Very sick indeed.
Rosko's third and final question was, you can go back to any period throughout history, which time do you go back to? So, the capitalist in me wants to go back to the 80s, and the hippie in me wants to go back to the 60s. Yeah. Or now, I think now is a very interesting time. So now, those two, I mean, or the future, I don't know. Don't know how that might scare me, actually. It's a fucking scary thought in the future. So yeah, capitalist in me wants the 80s, hippie in me wants the 60s. Right, so question from Badger this month. Badger said, just wondering what your thoughts about some movies based on hip-hop, such as Straight Outta Compton and All Eyes on Me. Just wanted to know if you find them disrespectful or misrepresentative, etc. I enjoyed Straight Outta Compton. I didn't enjoy All Eyes on Me so much, I don't think. I think the trouble you kind of get when you're doing like biopics, especially on a dead person, is they can easily be misrepresented. So you're just going off of like what someone else kind of wants to portray about that person. Like, I mean, look at the Bible. You've got all these different fucking parts written by different people, just their sort of like view on it. It's not like, do you mean it's just stories. So it's like, yeah, I think they can kind of be kind of disrespectful, can't they? Because it's you just, someone's opinion. I remember like the whole thing with when the Biggie film come out, and Lil Kim being really pissed off of like how she was portrayed in that. So it's always gonna be like so many different stories. So me personally, I would rather watch a documentary series, an in-depth like documentary on on an artist. So you're taking into account all different people's perspectives and opinions. And you, like, it's kind of unbiased because you've got their opinions, and you kind of make your own mind up. Maybe with like a little bit of dramatization in there, like a bit of acting, like of certain scenes and stuff. But yeah, I think you kind of need to take the aspects for all people, because a biopic is, at the end of the day, unless the people are alive and they can kind of like say, this is how it was, you're only going to get like some viewpoint like of what that person feels. So yeah, that's my opinion. I think I'd rather watch a documentary than a biopic. So Kirsty Clinch said, what is my favorite platform and why? Right, so YouTube is my favorite platform. I mean, YouTube's the daddy in it. So if you wanna learn how to play guitar, YouTube's got you. If you wanna take a radiator off the wall to learn how to paint behind it, YouTube's got you. You wanna watch a documentary, YouTube's got you. You want a music video, YouTube's got you. Yeah, it's just, the daddy in it, really. I like YouTube. If you're talking about a platform to consume music, I don't know. I think they're all pretty much the same, aren't they? They're all streaming sites these days. Spotify is no doubt the biggest, so I always try and push Spotify, because that's where the most people are. But yeah, YouTube and Spotify, I'd say. And then Kirsty's final question is, what do you think about the new live streaming rules on Facebook? They're not actually new rules. They've always been there. I think if you're an electronic DJ, it's kind of bad for you, because you play other people's songs. If you're a cover artist, but then even if you're a cover artist, if you've got the licenses to do the covers, or if you're doing your own music, I don't see really what the issue is. I mean, like, you've got the rights to play your own music, so it's your songs. I wouldn't really worry about it. I think it's more like them just like they're a fucking corporate company. Do you know what I mean? From their standpoint, it's like they're just basically like covering their ass to, I do think it helps the musicians. So if you're doing your music, or if someone's playing your song, or someone's doing your shit, and they're making money from it, then it's a bit shit, really, isn't it? So I kind of think it can work in your favor, but yeah, it's not actually new, and I don't actually think it's that much of an issue. But then, I don't know, if it is that much of an issue, it's fucking, it's their platform. At the end of the day, we can choose where we want to live stream and what we want to do. I mean, if they make holes, I mean, adapt or die, innit? I think it's easy to sit there and fucking complain about these big companies, but at the end of the day, we've always got a choice of where we put our music or where we play live. We don't have to. I mean, kind of makes it easier because Facebook's fucking massive, but yeah. Yeah, that's my opinion on it anyway. So yeah. But yeah, cool. As always, thank you for everyone who put their questions. Put your questions below if you've got any for next month. And yeah, I'll see you next week for another video. Safe.